Aló, probando. Okay, vamos a comenzar. Por favor. The Department of Languages, Literature and Communication presents What Happens When the Brain Gets Injured. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this activity called Let's Talk About Psychology, organized by the Department of Languages, Literature and Communication of Universidad de la Frontera, with the support of the Faculty of Education, Social Sciences, and Humanities. This is the second of three psychology talks that are being held out. The previous one was last week, and the next one is going to be within the next few weeks. The general purpose of this cycle of talks is to give both students and teachers, as well as teachers in the school system, the opportunity to enlarge their knowledge about different academic and scientific topics. And most important of all is to give you the opportunity to see an opportunity in which you can hear the English language being used. And we want to thank all the students present here and teachers as well. Thank you for being here with us presentially, and as well as the ones that are connected via the online room. And first of all, we will have a presentation by a PhD in experimental psychology. And then we will have some time for questions and comments that you may have after the presentation. So if you are participating in the online room, you can also write your questions in the chat when the moment comes. On this occasion, we are pleased to introduce the PhD in experimental psychology, Dr. Lucio Rehbein, who earned his degree from the Northeastern University in the US. He is a professor at the Universidad de la Frontera, where he has spent his academic career since 1985. Additionally, in his career as a researcher, he has been awarded research grants from various sources, has delivered more than 70 presentations and conferences, and has published more than 60 articles and chapters. Dr. Lucio is going to talk about different sources of injury that cause dysfunction on the brain and how they differ among them, what the chances for recovery and or rehabilitation there are as well. So without further ado, let's receive him with a round of applause.
Good morning. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your welcome, warm welcome. Let me first say that it's been a few years I haven't talked in English, so maybe my English is a little bit rusty, you know, oxidated. But I hope you can manage to understand most of what I say. The topic of today has as a main target the brain, although we are not going to go very deep into the brain or into scientific matters of referring to the brain. We're going to just skim over a little bit, you know, and you will be amazed of how many lexicological new terms you will hear. And you will be most amazed because most of those terms are understandable for us, you know, for Spanish speaking people, because they have Latin roots. You know, most of the words in biology and medicine have some Latin roots. Most of them, you know, because they picked up from the Renaissance scientists who described for the first time many of the functions and structures of the body. But enough of that. We are going to talk about the brain. It was working, but now it's not. Please help. I hope this doesn't happen very often during the talks, you know. Otherwise, you will be very much distracted. Anyway, the brain, which is allocated inside of this hard, bony structure, is a very delicate structure of our bodies. It's one of the most delicate organs in our bodies, and it carries out very complex functions. Let me introduce our main character of the talk. You know, this is the brain. You're seeing the left side of the brain. You know, if you took off my bone is surrounding the brain, you will see that. Okay, and this it weighs about 1.5 kilos, and it occupies. It was not sounding, and nobody said anything. You know, you should protest. You said stop. You know, make the microphone work. Now we are okay with this. Now, the brain is, as I said, one of the most delicate, but at the same time most protected areas of our bodies. You know, it has a bony bony wrapping. Underneath the bone, there is a very hard membrane called the dura mater, and beyond that, just in front of the, I shouldn't move my hand, in between the dura mater and the surface of the brain, there is liquid. It's the cerebral spinal liquid, which is a pressurized bath in which the brain swims. You know? So if there is something that hits our heads, first it's the bone, then it's the dura mater, and then it's the liquid that buffers, amortiguates the bump. Huh? So it's very well protected. On the other hand, from the inside, the brain is also protected from any harmful substances that may come through the blood flow. You know, through the flow of the blood that irrigates the brain from the inside. There is a so-called blood-brain barrier. It's a barrier which is not physical, as it is the dura mater or the bones. It's functional. There is always cells, specialized cells, which are intermediate between the walls of the blood vessels and the neurons. And those cells are one kind of cell called glia, glial cells. And any substance that would have to be transported towards the nervous system or the nervous tissue is filtered first by those other cells. So there is nothing, well, nearly nothing harmful that goes through there. Mostly what goes through is oxygen and glucose. You will be amazed to know that the brain weighs in about 2% of the body weight of a young, healthy person, consumes 20% of all the oxygen that the body consumes, 20% of the oxygen. And it feeds itself, it uses as food, only glucose, nothing else. Okay, so when people sometimes haven't eaten or haven't consumed glucose for a long time, they became languish, you know, they sort of lose their alert or their conscious ability, you know. Anyway, so we have the brain protected from the outside and from the inside. All of these are I mentioned already. So, but still, the brain gets injured. The brain receives some harmful consequences from events from inside and from the outside. There are at least five main sources of injury or lesions to the brain, which are this that I listed here: cerebrovascular accidents, or CVAs, as they are by short named, head traumas, tumors, infections, and degenerative diseases. Instead of advancing the slide, I turn off the microphone. Anyway, we are going to look at each one of these.
Again.
We are going to take a quick look at each one of these sources of damage to the brain, okay? First, we're going to see the cerebrovascular accidents. They are the most frequent among neurological diseases. They represent about approximately 50% of all hospitalized neurological patients. You know, there are other patients from neurological consequences or lesions that are also reach also the hospital, or get us deeply involved in damage that they have to be receive medical attention. But from those, from 100%, 50% are coming from cerebrovascular accidents. And it is also the third most frequent cause of death. There are some other names which are used to refer to cerebrovascular accidents. I already mentioned CVAs. Ictus, apoplexy, or stroke, which is a hemorrhage inside the brain. Okay, CVAs represent. I'm referring to the overall group. You know, CVAs represent a heterogeneous group of vascular disorders, among which we find lesions or alteration of vascular permeability. You know, sometimes due to other reasons, you know, the permeability of the vessels are altered by neurochemical or other reasons, you know, and it produces a shortage or a diminution of glucose or oxygen in the surrounding tissue, and that is called ischemia. Occlusion of the vessel due to thrombosis or embolism. When a blood vessel becomes ruptured, breaks because the walls of the vessel are hardened by cholesterol or the deposition of fatty matter like saturated acids, you know, fat acids. The arteries, which are usually tubes, which are very very elastic, you know, and they receive the influx from the heartbeat, you know, and there is a surge of blood that goes through, you know, you can see it, how the swelling and the it's, you know, it's like having elastic socks, you know. If you put something inside, like your fist or whatever, you know, it expands as the fist advances, but when it afterwards it comes back to the original shape. I keep doing movements and stuff that may illustrate the attendance here, but it may become a problem to whoever is listening to us through the internet. No problem. Oh, good, great. Okay. When the vessel breaks, you know, there is a natural reaction from any tissue that breaks. It becomes, you know, it starts a process of healing, which the first step is producing a blood clot, a clot. You know, the clot impedes, or there is another word. It precludes. using different act, but it prevents, you know, the blood from flowing to the surrounding tissue. Therefore, the clot is a more thick particle or aggregation of particles. So the clot may then obstruct or become a cup, and the blood does not go through, you know, in the vessel, because it's in the process of becoming repaired, biologically repaired. But then there is this effect. There is a thrombosis. You know? Thrombosis is the obstruction of the flow of the blood flow in the vessel. Therefore, the surrounding tissue, the tissue that goes beyond there, that is beyond the place of the injury, does not receive enough oxygen, particularly oxygen. That's the most immediate need of all the tissue, you know. So there is a consequence from there. But the other thing that may happen is that that blood clot gets loose from the wound and travels, is taken along by the blood flow, and when it gets to a narrower tube, it gets there like a cork, you know, and in that area also obstaculizes. It becomes a barrier, and the blood does not reach the surrounding tissue. And then again, there is no oxygen or glucose reaching those cells. Okay, that's occlusion. Now, there is rupture, which is also coupled with occlusion. You know, but now we are going to talk about the rupture of the vessel by itself. You know, the bleeding that may occur towards the surrounding tissue. It puts a lot of pressure there, and that pressure also causes the disconnection of the neurons to the next neurons in the chain. So there is a physical disruption also. There's not only the lack of food, it's also a sort of a pushing away of the neurons surrounding, therefore provoking a disconnection between elements of the brain. Okay, now there is also an increased viscosity or other qualitative changes in the blood, and this is possibly occurred by extreme dehydration, or it may occur by other electrochemical, non-electrochemical, physical chemical changes in the blood, which then makes it hard for their heart to pump and have the circulation of the brain fluid and enough, rapid enough, fast enough for the feeding of the tissue. And there is also a fifth way of a gastrointestinal, cerebrovascular. We're talking about two different important things. You know, you can tell that the gastrointestinal part of myself is very important. So, but let's keep talking about the brain. Now, sometimes there are developmental malformation of vessels, and I'm going to talk about only one, which is the aneurysms. Sometimes an artery in the brain turns around like an elbow, like this, you know. The blood comes here, it hits the front wall of the vessel and continues. If this happens for many years, why this is so, it's an express, there's no explanation. It's just something that occurred during the gestation and the formation of the biological being that we are, you know? And sometimes, you know, so after many years, this elbow becomes to yield, you know, the wall yields and it becomes dilated. And at some point, if you have a big emotional outburst, or if you have an accident or whatever, the increase of pressure breaks that little amp, yeah? And that produces there, some of the effects that we have already mentioned. Now, don't laugh at me. Okay, here are a couple of examples of a hemorrhage, you know, with bleeding towards the brain tissue caused by a stroke, you know, the breaking of the vessel. And here, it's an example, more or less in a similar area of the brain. Yeah, these are just illustrating drawings, you know? Illustrating drawings. I should hang the microphone here. I'm sorry, I'm not used to this, but I'll make my best from now on. So here we have, as I said, a hemorrhage or a bleeding towards the brain tissue caused by the breakage of an artery. And here we have the picture of a ischemic lesion by the fact that there is a thrombosis. There is prevention of circulation of the blood in the area that is beyond the place of the lesion. So in both cases, we have a very important damage, but it's different. You know? It's different. If in the case of an ischemic stroke or accident, you know, if you solve that with medicine that dissolves the clots, then this, most of this tissue may recover, yeah, may continue being alive with some interspersed dead neurons, but on the general scene, it may recover. Okay. Some of the consequences. Excuse me. Some of the consequences are maybe as important in terms of perceptual, motor, or cognitive malfunctions as an aphasia or a hemiplegia or a loss of memory or things like of that sort, you know. And then again, some depending on what kind of lesion, in which area, in which area it occurred, and how what the type of lesion was, the recovery may occur faster or slower or no recovery at all. On the other hand, as I mentioned here, the majority of CVAs take place without causing any pain. You know, the brain doesn't ache. There is no pain in the head but from the brain. When we have a headache, is pain coming from the dura mater, you know, the sheet that involves that surrounds the brain. That's the most sensitive, and it's the last barrier in terms of sensation, you know. So if we feel a pain in the head, is because the dura mater is being affected, okay? Which of course should be affected from the inside out. For example, if there is a tumor pushing out or something, you know. Okay, but CVAs may occur, may be small, may go unnoticed, they may go undiagnosed, and therefore the person who suffers them may not become aware of it. But if we accumulate the effect of many small CVAs, we may be in the presence of a multi-infarction dementia. You know, if many years go by, you know, people whose brains are opened and looked at after they die, they are full of holes, little holes. You know, it's like a colador. What's this? Like a colador. Anyway, so and that is one of the sources of dementia, of cognitive decline, which has no recovery. We will move to the second important source of injuries to the brain. It's the traumatic head injuries. These are the most common forms of brain damage. The behavioral effects of all brain lesions depend on the variety of factors, as I mentioned before, such as severity, the age of who suffers the lesion, I didn't mention that before, site or place of the lesion, and the premorbid personality. You know, the behavioral consequences may depend on how we were before, huh? how we were before. But in the case of head trauma, the psychological consequences also vary according to how the injury happened. If it was an injury occurred while moving, like in a vehicle, like in a car, or if it happened like a bump in the head, you know, a blow in the head, like a hammer falling down to your head. Or if something goes through your head, you know, like a bullet or like any projectile, missile that transverses your head, you know, that comes in and out. It depends on those things, you know. The main sources of head traumas are traffic accidents, both as a passenger and as a pedestrian, you know. If a car hits you in the street, you know, and you go around a couple of times in the air and fall with your head first, then there is a traffic accident. You know? There are falls. You know, people doing different things may fall. You know, and many cases imply also a bump in the head. You know, not necessarily fall head first, but once they hit the ground, the head also goes and hits the soil or the floor. Aggressions. This is interesting. Victims from third parties aggressions, people who become involved in fights and stuff, or are being assaulted or injured by someone who wants to take some of your belongings away, you know. And others, which are, you know, sports lesions, scuba diving, whatever, many other things, but the major ones are traffic accidents and falls. Approximately 10% of the persons who receive head injuries die before receiving medical attention. About 15% dies in the hospital, and those who survive, about 15% become incapacitated. So they need it. You know, they have a back injury or some hemiplegic or quadriplegic consequences. Head traumas occur more often in men, or I shouldn't say that. I should say that the statistics from head injuries in the counting of frequency, you find twice as many men as women injured in the head. And in 40% of the cases, traumatic accidents are associated with consumption of alcohol. So you should be aware of that. It's not a very healthy for many reasons. One of them is that you may become involved in an accident. One of the accidents, which is one of the effects from especially moving vehicle accidents, is this effect. There is a bump, you know, when the car hits the tree, you know, you go forward and you hit your front head in the dashboard, but then you go back and your brain hits the back of your skull. So this is one accident, but there are two harmful consequences. You know, there's this tissue which becomes smashed, and this tissue which becomes smashed. Therefore, the effect of the moving vehicle accident or the traffic accident with being a passenger or a driver is much more deleterious, much more grave in its consequences. Consequences of head trauma. When there is a skull fracture and direct damage to the tissue, to the brain tissue, that has particular influences. But then there is also, when there is a skull fracture, there is, how to say, pieces of the bone that comes and destroys also inside. However, we will see at the end of this listing, open skull fractures or injuries or wounds with bleeding, with actual bleeding outside, are much less harmful than closed injuries to the brain. When there is an opening and the bleeding goes outside, there is no pressure build up inside. Therefore, there is no damage to other tissue by the pressure, by the increase of pressure. Also, there is a faster scarring process. There is a scarring process because when in closed injuries, there is very little possibility for scarring. Other consequences are, as we have seen earlier, interruption of the blood supply, intracranial hemorrhage, increased pressure. That's one consequence that brings other results. Inflammation and swelling, that is, especially if not in CVAs, but in infections, when there is an open wound, there is also the high probability of an infection occurring in the place of the wound. Yeah. Which is what is mentioned there. Generation of scar tissue. Now, when there is generation of scar tissue, scars are a way of putting together the scattered pieces of the tissue. Therefore, it's connected tissue. It's a specialized tissue we have in our body in all areas. You know, all the scarring is done by connective tissue, and inside the brain, when there is scarring. It may be scary, but it's scarring. It holds together neurons which are usually working in some functioning, and it leaves them tensionated, you know, pulled and distorted in their original forms, to the point that any little change in pH or in any physical chemical conditions of the surrounding area will generate the functioning, an exacerbated response from that tissue, and that may produce convulsive crisis. This is usually the cause of epilepsy, which occurs not early on in life, but it occurs usually in 1 or 2 years after a head accident, okay? Now, I already mentioned the difference between open and closed head injuries. The open head injuries do not come with a loss of consciousness. You know, people keep being conscious, and the bleeding goes outside, and there is faster healing, etc. Even though it may look very messy, you know, it may cause you a great impression by what you see. Nonetheless, the head, you know, the closed head injury, you may see nothing happen to the person, but actually inside, there is an enormous pressure, enormous swelling, enormous dysfunctional, dislocking of neurons communicating with each other, with one another. And therefore, people lose consciousness. They go black, you know, like when your TV gets unplugged, goes black. Okay, the third important, how are you going to with time, Matthias? Are we exceeding our time already? Huh? No? We're okay, thank you. The third major source of injury to the brain are brain tumors. Brain tumors are neoplasms which are unrestricted proliferations of brain cells. Actually, neoplasms are the same in anywhere, any tissue of the body, you know. It's new cells which lose the break or the contention effect of genetic signals to grow and mature. Instead, these start renewing or changing proliferation without ever maturing. You know, so it's a disenfrenate. It's unrestricted, as I say, proliferation of brain cells forming a growing mass within the cranial or spinal cavities. They can be primary, which means that they have their origin in brain tissue itself, or they may be secondary, which means that they are metastatic. They come from another organ, from a cancer that originated in another organ of the brain and managed to go usually through the bloodstream and holds on in one corner somewhere, you know, and start proliferating. Tumors can grow by infiltrating the surrounding tissue or by remaining encapsulated. When tumors are encapsulated, which usually are called more benign tumors, they can be extirpated. They can be taken out by surgery more easily without leaving behind some traces. And also it depends on how early they are intervened. But when the tumors are infiltrating, the malignancy of the tumor is greater, and it's almost impossible to take out because they go around like the branches of a tree, you know, in between. So it is impossible to follow it and take it out cleanly by a surgeon, a neurosurgeon. Then I say tumors are the second most common cause of death from a brain lesion. The first one, do you remember which was the first one? CBAs, very good. CBAs. Because of their size, location, and invasive qualities, tumors tend to destroy the tissue where they stand and display the tissue surrounding them, producing a wide variety of neurological and neuropsychological symptoms. Now, if the tumor is encapsulated and it is taken out by the surgeon, most of these symptoms regress. They normalize, or the functioning normalizes. Yeah. If there is not had time enough to produce more pervasive damaging effects. Here we have an image of a tumor, okay, which is located by a CAT scan. And here is a sample of how a tumor can be usually one of the problems of taking out surgically a tumor is that in the way for the surgeon to go and get it, you know, and get in at the base of the brain or whatever, it destroys much more healthy tissue than what the tumor is doing itself. So one of the tricks is to destroy it by laser bombarding, and usually using two beams of laser, so that no one by itself causes damage, but when they come together, which should come together in the exact point of the tumor, it burns it out. Okay. Well, brain tumors are of different sorts. As I already mentioned, you know, the ones that have their origin in brain cells itself, and they are called gliomas or meningiomas or metastatic. Gliomas and meningiomas occur within the head or the brain or the spinal cord, and the metastatic tumors have their origin in somewhere else, and they become lodged in the brain. Okay, and these gliomas are about 45% of all brain tumors and they are distributed between these different sorts of support cells within the brain, astrocytes, they are called, I don't remember how they are called, but the glioblastomas are glial cells which surround the nerve fibers to isolate them from short circuiting. And the medulloblastomas are usually in the medulla, usually by the name, they are in the spinal cord. And those two, glioblastomas and medulloblastomas, are the most deadly ones. They are very, very ferocious and not encapsulated. Now, the symptoms that may be indicative of brain tumors, of the presence of brain tumors, are typically pervasive headaches, yeah, which are not buffered or healed or diminished by a pain medication, vomiting, persisting vomiting, swelling of the optic disc, which is the disc where the at the bottom of the at the back of the retina, where all the nerve fibers go to the brain, there is a disc there which becomes very swollen. Mental clouding, mental clouding is a symptom that may accompany many other things, you know. And double vision, diplopia, double vision. People see like two different images, one with one eye and the other. So the chairs become blurred, persons become blurred. And that is all of that occurs because there is a elevated blood pressure, not blood pressure, intracranial pressure due to the expansion of the tumor. Now we come to the fourth type of brain injury or cause of brain injury. First, we'll look at the distinction between two different effects from agents that cause inflammation and infection. One is called encephalitis. Encephalitis is an inflammation of the brain caused by an infectious agent. I mean, by a bacteria or a virus or a parasite. Whereas encephalopathy is an inflammation of the brain caused by an inert agent, like a chemical agent, a physical agent, allergic reactions, toxics, etc. Okay, so this distinction, the early on, the physician or the neurologist who may have to attend a person who is who comes to the hospital has to make a quick differential diagnosis, because the course of treatment, in one sense, if it is encephalitis, is one, and if it is encephalopathy, is other. And then you know, there is a long trip to uncover which specific agent it is causing either one. Okay. Now the types of infections are viral, bacterial, fungal, and parasitic. We will take a quick look at each one of those. We'll take a quick. We'll take a quick look at each one of them. In the case of viral infections, we have to distinguish two types of viruses. One is a neurotrophic virus, which has a predilection. It seeks, it looks for nervous tissue. You know, it looks to get into the brain. It does not harm other tissues. It goes to the brain. And that is the poliomyelitis, and the rabies virus. They are neurotrophic. They seek nervous tissue to insert themselves. And there are pantrophic viruses which go to other places of the brain, which is the mumps, the herpes simplex, of course the herpes complex also, but the herpes are very, very bothersome viruses. Mumps are the ones that make your throat swollen. Mumps, papillas. Okay, those are viral infections. Now, we're not going to get into the details of what happens with each sort of infection because we don't have that. But here you have here is a bacteria that is eating the tissue.
Microphone. Oh my goodness, I should have a microphone allocated in my throat so that I wouldn't have to forget this. Okay. And the other one, that's it. Would you guess which is that one? It has accompanied us for years, for the last 2 years. That's the coronavirus. The coronavirus also affects the brain, not preferably the brain, but it does get to the brain. And it has some sequela, intellectual or psychological sequela. In some cases, people lost their memory or have a more slow processing of things, etc. But there are sequela. Fortunately, I didn't lose my English when I got sick from that. Bacterial infections. Bacteria are unicellular organisms that do not make photosynthesis and who multiply themselves by simple division. Yeah, a couple of examples, meningitis, which is an infection by meningococci. I practice that in and brain abscesses. And brain abscesses are infections, localized infections that produce some reaction from the body, you know, and you have lots of white matter that you push out, you know, and you have to clean it, and okay, brain abscesses. Then there is a fungal infection, mycosis. The fungus is any member from a group of inferior plants lacking chlorophyll, that subsist from organic matter. It eats other things, living or dead. You know, and those are examples of those are yeasts, mold, and mushrooms. Those are fungi. Yeah. Do you understand what yeasts are? People use it to make beer. And molds are those green little things that grow on the southern part of the stone. And mushrooms, of course, we eat them. Some of them. Right. We eat them. I'm sorry. I next time I will build a cabestrillo here. Okay, parasitic infections. Parasite is a guest organism that lives on top of or inside another organism, which is called the host, and at its expenses. Parasites do not produce their own food. They eat what the what the host offers them, which is usually the case when we have guests, you know. They eat our food. Two examples, amoebiasis, which is an amoeba that eats our intestinal, when we get infested, when we get infested by amoeba, they produces an enormous upset in our intestinal system and have to be treated by, you know, very radical measures. And the malaria, which is also a parasite. Okay, you can Google them. If you want to find out how terrible they are, Google them. Of course, a honorable teacher in front of you should not say that. But Google is pretty reliable, mostly, you know. Anyway, and the last group of as I get more tired, I tend to forget more about this. Degenerative diseases. You will have to edit a lot of this, my friend. If you are recording it, you will have to edit it a lot. Dementia is one of the common ways of referring to the results of degenerative diseases. Dementia is an acquired loss of intellectual functions, different from deterioration associated with age, and different from mental retardation. So it's a serious diminution of autonomous functioning. The term dementia refers to irreversible loss of autonomy and intellectual capacities like memory, ability to express oneself and communicate, to organize daily family life, work and social life, etc. From the subtleties and inadvertences of the earliest signs and symptoms, it gets progressively worse, leading to a state of total dependence and finally to death. There are several types of dementias. They are grouped by referring first to cortical dementias, that means dementias from the degenerative processes in the cerebral cortex, frontal subcortical dementias, which refer to degeneration in certain nuclei from the base of the brain and some cortical connections to the base of the brain. The cortical dementias are Alzheimer's disease, Pick's disease, and Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease. Pick's disease is not so often. The most familiar one for you and for me and for everyone is Alzheimer's disease. No? And the less common one is Creutzfeldt-Jakob's disease, which is commonly called, named by the crazy cows dementia. Huh? Then there is the frontal subcortical, I said, that we have Parkinson's disease, Huntington's disease, multi-infarct dementia, which I mentioned it earlier, and progressive supranuclear palsy. Progressive supranuclear palsy is mostly a developmental disorder. It's not something that one acquires in adulthood. It's something that you grow up with. And then there is axial dementia, Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, which is typically produced by chronic alcohol consumption, especially whiskeys and distilled stuff,
Wine, I made myself a point to inquire about it. Wine doesn't cause it. So I can continue on with my happy life. And then there is mixed dementias, post-traumatic dementias, infectious dementias, toxic dementias, normal pressure hydrocephalus, etc. There are, you know, the most common ones are Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and maybe multi-infarct dementia. For the occasion, we're going to just take a quick look to Alzheimer's disease before we finish this conversation. There is here half of the brain, there is a cut in the middle, you know, and you have a healthy brain on the left and a brain of a person with severe Alzheimer's disease. Okay, then you see how the degenerative process has eaten out or has caused the loss of about over 50% of the brain mass. And the picture on the right, I'm sorry, I forgot I have water. The picture on the right shows an image with a lesion in the basal ganglia. And that's a lesion causing Parkinson's disease. Okay. In the case of Alzheimer's type dementia, one can see two different groups of changes. One group is called personality changes, and the other one is intellectual changes. In personality changes, you can appreciate an enhancing of previous features up to an eccentricity. You know, people who have certain skills or manias or certain ways of doing things. They may be too irritable or maybe like to talk dirty language, or maybe they can. Then anything that was typical from that person earlier, with the Alzheimer's dementia, it becomes extremely exacerbated. You know? And then there is also apathy or lack of interest in starting any new activities. You know, they go and act like nothing very important. They are distractible and become fatigued easily. They lose their sense of humor. And they lack of insight into what's happening to him or her. You know, they don't have a clue of what's going on with myself. You know, they just behave like everything was not normal. And then in intellectual changes, we have clearly a memory loss, both recent and remote memory loss. We have confusional thinking and inability to make decisions. We have word finding difficulties, spatial disorientation, incontinence, and of course they are unaware of their own disease. Okay? So those are the two groupings of symptoms. Of course, this may occur in a lapse of 2, 3, 4 years. In some persons it occurs very abruptly, very quickly, and some others it takes more time. But one of the astounding things from people who suffer from Alzheimer's is that there is an incongruence, there is a lack of correspondence between their physical health. They may be very healthy. You know, no, there is no ailment that affects the body, but up here, everything is kaput.
Okay. And that's all for today. So.
Many thanks, Dr. Rehbein. That was a very interesting talk. It was excellent. I'm pretty sure you explained some concepts that some of us only knew by name, and it was very, very interesting and kind of terrifying. but it was okay. Now we will have time for some questions. So if any, we invite all of you to raise your hand if you have any question, and we can lend you over the microphone so you can ask your inquiries to Dr. Rehbein. And from everybody in the online room as well, you can ask your questions in the chat if you have any and you wish to participate. Don't worry about your pronunciation or anything. It's just, we want you to communicate the idea. That's it, the fluency. So the space is open over there.
Doctor? In the case of...
In the case of Alzheimer's type dementia, the personality changes. We can only have personality changes, or only intellectual changes, or can be mixed.
Yeah, no, you have the two kinds of changes. Yes, intermixed. No, it's just, this is just a, how do you say, pedagogical way of sorting out things, but it all comes together.
Anyone else? Maybe you can ask in Spanish.
I'm sorry. Let me add one thing about Alzheimer's. One of the things that is very striking, and people become afraid, I myself become afraid, because Alzheimer's is distinguished by a tremendous word finding difficulty. You know, people are talking and can't find the word, you know, can't find the word. And sometimes they recur to some circumlocal way of expressing the idea, but they get lost. They get lost also in what some of the words from the circle documents. And so it's a very, when I cannot find the word, I say, am I getting Alzheimer's disease? that's a very distinctive feature.
Are there no more questions? What about in the online room?
No, the online group is posing a question. Was he using a microphone? Yes. Indicators, you mean? There are indices or there is nothing that could tell you 100% at the beginning. At the beginning, all of those things may occur with a low frequency, and the frequency may become increased. So you have to be monitoring, or actually, the only way is that the family members, you know, who have been witness of that behavior, of the behavior of that person during a lifetime, you know, now they begin to see this thing up to a point. Usually, memory losses. You know, the memory loss is the first thing that becomes uncomfortable or bothersome for the family members, and they finally decide to take the person to consult a neurologist or a physician in general. And from then on, the the monitoring of the changes are followed, and then you can put things together, you know. But there is no distinctive one indicator of Alzheimer's. What appears the earliest, maybe the word finding difficulty, and which is a memory difficulty. You know? It's a language storage, lexicon storage, recovery problem. But word finding difficulty and memory problems are the first most noticeable changes. But they may come from other, you know, from other sources as well. You know, it could not necessarily be Alzheimer's disease.
Yeah. Okay, seems like there are no more questions, right? What else? No. All right. So once again, we would like to thank Dr. Rehbein for his presentation and for being here. Thank you for sharing with us this topic. It's really important and very, very interesting. So yeah, many thanks once again. And now for finishing, thank you all for being here as well. And now we would like you to answer some questions. We're going to present you a QR code right here because your opinion is important and we want you to help us organize future talks and everything. So where is the code? It's right there. There it is. The idea was to project here over here, but seems like something happened. I don't know. And where's the and we will share a link for the online classroom as well. We'll just need a minute for this. It's going to be difficult. Okay, and okay, this is the end of the presentation. And as we mentioned at the beginning, this is the second of three psychology presentations that are being held by the faculty. And the next one is within the next few weeks. Some of you probably already signed up for them, but in case you haven't, we will send you an invitation via email once again, later, I don't know if today, but soon, very soon. So, thank you very much again for your participation. And that's it. See you soon. Thank you, doctor, for being here.